because you can't hear output, just start at 30.
Good evening and welcome to the State of London debate, live and exclusive on LBC. Between now and 9 o'clock, it's your chance to challenge the Mayor of London on any issue you like. You can get involved on Twitter by using the hashtag AskBoris and watch us in high definition at lbc.co.uk, where you can also follow the LBC Twitter worm, showing how people on social media think the mayor is doing. A brief word. Boris Johnson is now midway through what he's indicated will be his second and last term as mayor. Many key issues confront him: shortage of housing, cycling safety, balancing the books. There's even an unholy row over Uber. So, how will the man who thrilled us all with his high wire act in the run-up to London 2012 react to these challenges? Will he slink off like Roy's boys in Brazil? Or get his teeth into it as if he were a Luis Suarez in the box? Allegedly. There's only one way to find out. Ladies and gentlemen, for one night only, this becomes the Bojo 2. Please welcome the Mayor of London, Boris Johnson.
Good evening. Good evening. Thank you, Nick. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening. Good evening. Thank you very much, Nick. It's great to be here tonight. Thank you very much. Thank you. I have just had my hair cut. Thank you very much indeed to the first heckler. And what an enormous crowd we've got tonight, Nick. What do you think has drawn them to the O2 in such unprecedented numbers?
Probably not your public transport system, but you carry on, Mr.
Which is running brilliantly. Is it that photograph of us that appears on the tube looking like some government health warning about the perils of obesity? Well,
I thought it was broke.
I think they've come to. This is where I give my
I know.
Spiel.
I'm just finished with this. I thought it was Brokeback Mountain too. That's what I was hoping.
I thought it was romantic. It was romantic to a degree that
Mr. Mayor's opening remarks.
Positively unsettling. Anyway, thank you everybody for coming. I think when you look around this part of London, actually look around the whole of London, you can see that the economic recovery, is now in full swing, because the landscape now resembles one of those David Attenborough time-lapse BBC nature films about the return of spring to the Canadian Arctic or wherever, and the ice has retreated, and everywhere the place is bulging and writhing and sprouting with growth. And like some species of hyperactive beaver, the developers concentrate, Nick. The developers are back out of hibernation, and they're erecting their extraordinary buildings all over London: the Shard, the walkie-talkie, the Lady Shave, the cheese grater. And that, of course, is what happened years ago here, because it's quite right that we should be here in Greenwich, because this is formerly a completely contaminated post-industrial wasteland that is now the home of the largest live music venue anywhere in the world, which is where we are. And just next door, as a result of that regeneration, there are now going to be a further 10,000 homes built on Greenwich Peninsula, 1,740 at Millennium Village. And that is a story that is being replicated over and over again now across London, where the cranes are really up. And we've already built a record number of affordable homes, 78,000, but we can do far more on the 32 brownfield sites that are ready to take hundreds of thousands of affordable homes over the next 10 years. And we must do that because why must we do it? Because your Londoners need homes. And our population is booming. We had more live births. Absolutely nothing we can do about it, folks, or nothing I personally can do about it, or you personally. We had more live births in London last year than at any time since England won the World Cup in 1966. And couple that with the fact that life expectancy is going up. Where do they live longest in London? Anybody know? Not Kensington and Chelsea, funny enough, on the Harrow Road. on the Harrow Road, where they have what kind of monkey glands, I do not know, but their life expectancy is now up to 97.1 on the Harrow Road. Isn't that incredible? Take those two things together. Huge fecundity, natural fecundity, live births, increased life expectancy, and you've got a population booming. We're going up to 10 million people by the end of this, by 2030, perhaps 11 million people by 2050. And how do we make sure that we can build the homes that Londoners need? I'll tell you how we make those homes go. You fight crime. You continue to make this city ever safer, and the murder rate has been cut by 50%, roughly speaking, since I've been mayor. Overall crime is down by 17%. Bus crime is down by 40%. That's crime committed on buses, not crime committed by buses, which is very rare indeed. We have the safest tube system, the safest metro system, Nick, anywhere in the world. And even more important, perhaps, than fighting crime, you've got to put in the transport links, haven't you? That is what makes housing developments possible. And we've put in air conditioning on the tube. We've cut tube delays by 40% since 2008, to pick a date entirely at random. We have Crossrail coming in on time and on budget. We're building new bridges across a new tunnel here at Silvertown, Blackwall 2 crossing. And we will be putting it. It will be absolutely wonderful, by the way, and it will help Mr. Ferrari get to work. We are putting in Crossrail 2, which will have the same galvanizing effect on parts of the London property market that currently need to get going. Put all those things together. Housing, increasing security, good transport. You add an improving quality of life. The fantastic things we're doing to try to improve the quality of life. And I'm talking about planting tens of thousands of trees, improving public health, putting more bicycles on our streets, and we put thousands and thousands on our streets, having safer. Did you know this year the roads in London are the safest, I think, that they've been in more or less. We've had a biggest reduction in KSIs since records began. They're now down to 23% down on the previous year. Our roads are also getting safer. Put all those things together. Security, more housing, better transport, a better environment, better quality of life. What do you get?
London.
You get London. No flies on you. But I'll tell you what you also get. You get jobs. You get jobs. And you get economic growth and security and prosperity. And I'm proud to say that in this city, we now have employment at levels we have not seen for the last 22 years. Higher levels of employment for the last 22 years. Look at the back pages of the Evening Standard. Look at the back pages of the Evening Standard. Look at the demand for jobs in those advertisements there. You get an economic powerhouse here in London that is driving the rest of the country. And I think it is absolutely vital that we get the message across as Londoners to the rest of the United Kingdom that this is a city that cannot be shortchanged, that is vital to the economic future of our whole country. I'm very proud of what we're achieving. I'm very proud to be your mayor and to have served here in London for the last 6 or 7 years, or however long it is now. But I always know, and I always appreciate, that's why I've got my brilliant team here in the front row, looking wise as a tree full of owls. Here they all are. I always know there are things we can do better. There are ideas that we can learn from you, things we can pick up from you here at this session. That's why it's so important to have this State of London debate, and that's why it's so important to allow you to scrutinise and to interrogate me as politely as you feel able to do. Thank you very much indeed.
Let's hear it for the London Mayor. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Now, to remind you, if you have a question, please put your hand up. One of our team will come and find you with a microphone. You can also get involved on Twitter using the hashtag AskBoris. Let's get straight to business there. The picture from London from the mayor, importance of housing, the crime is down, the roads are safer. We need transport links, jobs the highest for 22 years. And the mayor says he wants to get this message out to the national audience. There's nowhere better than LBC because they are listening and indeed watching right across the country. We will start with the first round of questions. Keep those hands up. The team will get you just as quickly as we can. And we'd like to go first to Mike 3. No, I'm so... Yeah, Mike 3. Let's go to Mike 3. Mike 3.
Mike 3. Is that his name?
No. It's a young lady in a green top. That's microphone 3.
Sorry.
And we're going to take a cluster of 3, Mr. Mayor, so remember the question. Madam in the green top, you go first.
Hello, my name is Elaine Chambers. This concept of affordability is an exercise in obfuscation. It is said to be 80% of the market rents. Our key workers, even our young professionals, are not going to be able to afford such rents. Who do you think is going to live in London?
Well, come to another question, Mr. Mayor. We're going to take a cluster. Microphone number four. Where is microphone number four? Yes, can we get the question?
Will the Mayor assure us that London's Greenbelt won't be reclassified to brownfield and then developed with the use of biodiversity offsetting?
Yep. Thank you, sir. A Greenbelt question. And we finish with one more. We're going for, I think, another housing question. Is it mic two? Microphone two.
Yes, it's a bit similar to the first question. All these huge developments that Boris is waving through, even when the council doesn't want them, seem to be largely unaffordable to the general public and even to the target market.
Okay.
Which the developers say is...
Okay. Nice and deep into the microphone. Shout the question out, that last sentence, madam.
Yes, they seem to be unaffordable.
Unaffordable.
Even to their target market.
Even to the target market. Okay, thank you very much indeed.
Okay, well, let me try and deal with this, because it is incredibly important that we knock on the head this idea that it's 80%, that the affordable price is 80% of the market rent. It's the average is 65%, so it can be right down at 40% or whatever. 80% is the absolute limit, and most people are charging nothing like that. We've already built a record number of such affordable homes, 78,000 affordable homes. And let me tell you, in 1 year of this administration in London, there were more council homes built than in 13 years of Labour's administration. Now put that in your pipe and smoke it. Thank you very much for that small ripplelette. That small ripplelet of applause for that. And just on the who can afford it, I would just make this point that one of the things I think is grossly unfair about the current state of the London property market is that it's only people, as everybody knows, that it's grossly inflated now. The multiple of house prices to incomes is way out of line with what it should be. Many, many millions of people are finding it difficult to get onto the property ladder. But if you go for one of our schemes, like First Steps, where we will help you to buy a share in the value of your property, then we've helped already tens of thousands, I think about 36,000 people, I'm looking to see if Rick Blakeway, the housing guru, is here, onto that scheme. And on average, the household income there is about £33,000. And those people are getting a share in the value of the London property market. That is one very important thing. But the most important thing of all is to increase supply and to build hundreds of thousands of good new homes in London. To answer the question about the Green Belt, no, we won't do it in the Green Belt. We won't build on the Green Belt. It is not necessary. There are huge numbers of brownfield sites already, like this place where we are now, here in Greenwich, that can be brilliantly used for good quality housing, and that's where we should go first. We think we can build about 400,000 new homes, good new homes for Londoners, on the 33 opportunity areas that I've described.
Mr. Mayor, you've been in power since 2008. How many homes have been built in that time?
Well, I've given you the figure for the number of affordable homes, which is about 78,000.
Yes. So you've done 78,000...
And we're on target to do 100,000.
Over 6 years. Is that satisfactory?
Well... It's more than have ever been done before.
That wasn't the question, Mr. It's Mayor. Is that satisfactory?
It's not, but there's been no time, just to stress, if you look at the map of housing supply in London in the last century, we are running at roughly the levels it's been since the best year was in 1933 or thereabouts, when there was a massive spike in house building. What you say is completely correct, but it is what we're going through now is, I think, a massive housing boom. And if you look at where we're going to be in 2 years,
hang on, let's
two
listen to
time,
the mayor. Make yourself known to one of the microphones.
There are going to be a phenomenal number of homes built over the next 2 years. But what's a phenomenal number? I'm wagering here, but I would not be surprised if in the next 2 years we build a record number by more than have ever been built over the last 30 years.
Well, what number would that be? How many buildings are you building per annum currently?
Well, I've given you the figure. You work it out. I've given you the figure for what we've already achieved. I've said that we're on target to deliver more than 100,000 over two terms. That is a bigger rate of affordable home building than we have ever seen.
Mr. Mayor, the reality is you want to be building 42,000 per annum. You're currently building 21,000.
We want to be building 49,000.
Yeah, you're currently building at the rate of 21,000.
We want to be building 40. But right. what we're dealing with is 30 years of chronic failure to deal with London's housing need. And it is now starting to take off. We're now starting to see the numbers climb. But you've got to be very directional and very positive, and you've got to tell people sometimes that they can't be too nimbyish. And there are schemes that I greenlight that we get going, and I'm thinking, and people will be familiar. Every week I get through the mail. The letterbox in where I live, the Islington Tribune denouncing me for trying to get some scheme going at Mount Pleasant, which will deliver thousands of homes for Londoners, and they don't like it because they don't like the design. They think it's too dense, and what I'm saying respectfully to people, I think it's a beautiful design, by the way. It'll be a wonderful place to live. What I'm saying to people, we can't have it all ways. We can't insist that we build rows of thatched cottages or whatever it is that people want to live in, and simultaneously cope with our massive need for housing. We can build beautiful schemes. And sometimes, I think that, if I may respectfully say to some of my friends and colleagues in the boroughs, sometimes they can be a little bit slow to get those things off the ground. I mean, like we've just been talking today about Convoy's Wharf in Deptford. Anybody like the Convoy's Wharf in Deptford scheme? Okay, there you go. Now that's the voice of non-progress.
Right. Someone says it's a disaster.
It's been derelict for 17 years.
Mr. Mayor, it's been people saying it's a disaster that has stopped anybody building. Sir, homes. Just shout in a sentence. Why is Convoy's Wharf a disaster? The local council don't want it. And I can't see where you are.
There's not enough social housing there. In an area, South East London needs homes that people can afford to live in. Convoy's Wharf will not demand that. It will not give that at all.
Because? Too expensive.
Because it's dreaming, not us.
Okay. That's the voice. You chose to pick a local just up the road there, Convoy's Wharf in Deptford. There seems to be considerable opposition. Back to you, Mr. Mayor.
I've just got to repeat my point, that unless you get these schemes going, you get absolutely no housing there at all.
But this gentleman's saying they're unaffordable. They'll probably start at 280.
There'll be plenty of affordable. There is plenty of affordable housing on the site. There is 40. I think 40% of the Convoy's Wharf site. Thank you, Eddie. Is affordable. What you're really advocating is 40%. 40% of nothing.
All right.
And I don't think that is a sensible way forward. What London needs is good new homes, and that Convoy's Wharf site has been derelict for 17 years because of apathy, drift, and dither. And all I'm saying respectfully is you can't have it always.
If we
want more housing, which we do, then sometimes we've got to blast ahead and get on with it.
Let's take at least one more on housing. Microphone three. Mic three, please. Madam, go ahead.
You talk about what London needs. What about all the 60,000 empty homes that we already have?
The number of empty homes has been reduced to the lowest level since the 1970s.
We've
bought 25,000 empty homes
Have you gone around and counted
than
them?
Than there were in 2008. And I have personally authorised the counting of them. And just over 4,900 empty homes were brought back into use in the period 2008 to 2012, and we're going to do more. But the number of empty homes now, the vacancy rate in London is only 0.6%, and that is the lowest, as I say, it's been since.
But is it still 60,000?
Isn't 25,000 still too much? Shouldn't we, in fact, stop giving first refusal to outside investment? And shouldn't there be limitations on how long properties can remain empty in London or anywhere?
You're asking a question about whether a slightly different point, which is about people who buy international buyers who buy homes and then leave them vacant. And I certainly think that is completely wrong. And I would urge councils to use the powers that they have to impose swingeing council taxes on people who do that. And at the moment, there's only one borough, I think, to my knowledge. That is actually a couple more now, following my urgings.
They can afford those taxes. All right,
it. Now, on that, because I think there's a lot of.
They can afford the taxes. They need to be confiscated.
Where is this lady?
She's right in front of you. Literally in front of you.
Yes. Where is she?
Where that lady in the. Where the girl in the white shirt is. Look there. Yes.
Yeah. The difficulty is that it's very difficult to work out who. An international investor is anybody from the EU can count as an international investor. Irish people count as international investors. And currently, by volume, sales to foreigners, that's anybody who doesn't hold a UK passport. So what percentage of homes in London would you say by volume are going to people who don't hold a UK passport?
It's
3%.
Too many.
Too many
is what the. Well, you asked the question. 3%.
The answer is 3%, and by value, it's 6%, and that is the same level as it has been since for about 20 or 30, 40 years. Okay. Now, where I certainly agree with you is it's not right that people should be able to buy these homes and then not use them. So you put a swingeing council tax on. I also think, and this is a difficult problem. I think the mortgage market in Britain is not favourable to the London buyer, to British people who need to be able to compete for them. Now, that is a problem that we need to address.
Okay, we move
and
on.
We need them. We need our. I just want to. This is very,
briefly,
very important,
if you would, because there are people, other issues.
We need the mortgage market to allow people to buy these homes with a longer delay in the same way. In the same way that international buyers can.
Okay, we can return to housing, and we might. We must move on. Final question on housing. If there's only 3% of buyers from overseas, why do you go to all these property conferences in the south of France?
Because I think it's very, very important for London that we should be able to. Well, let me give you an example.
There's only 3% of buyers. Why are you talking to Russians and Chinese in the south of France?
Because the investors, the people who get these. I don't know whether anybody, whether Nick, you were, I don't know whether you were paying attention to what happened in Britain 6 or 7 years ago, but there was a massive financial crisis. And the banks were completely starved of liquidity and the developers couldn't move. And if you look at the sites, the schemes that we're talking about just in this area, the Greenwich Millennium projects, those are being financed by, I think, investors from Asia, from China. Now, you may say we don't want that nasty foreign money coming to London. Who wants to take a pitchfork and repel the evil, smelly foreign money?
All right.
The trouble is that we don't have enough British money, to put it in very simple terms, to do the kind of things that we need to do.
Okay.
And you can get schemes going with the help of international investment that would otherwise be completely derelict. Like Battersea Power Station. Does anybody believe? That's been derelict all my lifetime. Does anybody believe we would have regenerated Battersea Power Station if we didn't have the confidence of investors from Malaysia? It is very, very important that London should remain open to investment, open to ideas, okay, open to talent. That Mr. is the Mayor, future of our city.
We may return to housing. A couple of tweets from Ollie. From Ollie, not a great start from Boris on the housing issue. He hasn't answered the questions. And from Adam Bionkoff, Boris getting a tough ride on housing from the audience.
But he's a Labour student.
That doesn't preclude him.
He's some Labour stool
pigeon. It doesn't preclude him from tweeting, as everybody can, the biggest issue in London.
Adam Bionkoff. He's been tweeting against me solidly for 5 years.
Doesn't make him a bad person.
I'm not taking anything.
It doesn't make him a bad person, just because he tweets against you. We move on. Now, microphone two. Where is microphone two? Now, please. Yes. Madam.
I'm Wendy. How long do you plan to remain as Mayor of London? There's no point in us asking you any questions if you're going to quit or take on another job, which you give more attention to.
These are clusters, Mr. Mayor. Microphone three. How long will you remain? Microphone three. Sir, in the black shirt.
Okay. Given that you have a newspaper column and it's rumoured that you are standing for Parliament, does London deserve a full-time mayor?
Well, thank you. And lastly, microphone one. Microphone one, wherever you are. Microphone one.
Mr. Mayor, it's similar to question number one.
Could you wave your hand, whoever the LBC person is? Right, this one's over there. Go ahead, microphone one.
How can you justify your commitment to London when it seems you are using your post of mayor as a stepping stone for your seat in the parliament at the next general election?
A bit louder. How do you justify being mayor as you're using what, sir? Sorry.
How can you justify your commitment to London when it seems you are using your post of mayor as a stepping stone for your seat in the parliament at the next general election?
Okay, a stepping stone. Mr. Mayor, those 3 points, if you would.
Right.
Thank you.
Well, as I've said tirelessly ever since I was elected in 2008 and in 2012, again, I will fulfil my mandate that you've given me, and I will serve out my term as your mayor, and it's the best job in British politics. There's absolutely no question about it. And as for whether or not I'm entitled to spend some time writing newspaper articles... There have been previous mayors who've tried to write newspaper articles, and I think the previous incumbent even had a column on the Independent briefly, and then another one on restaurants possibly, or pubs or something, bars perhaps possibly. But I think it's very important for politicians to be able to express themselves in any medium that they feel comfortable in. You write a little bit. Nick?
I'm not a politician.
Oh, okay, no, well, perhaps one day.
Currently. Move on.
I think it's a good thing for my job that I'm able to get points across in
what
the
people
paper.
Want to know, Mr.
And,
Mayor.
And by the way, let me point out that I happen to have discovered this. When Winston Churchill was Chancellor of the Exchequer, he continued to write the history of the English-speaking peoples and do innumerable newspaper articles, and nobody whinged about that.
His articles weren't about playing tennis,
and indeed,
were they?
And indeed, as far as I can remember, he continued to write that when he got it when he was First Lord of the Admiralty in 1940, and Britain was at war.
I think, Mr.
So,
Mayor,
donnez-moi un break.
What I think I get from the room, before we move on to other matters, what are you going to do in 2 years' time? What are you going to do in 2 years' time?
Well, in 2 years' time, I will be relieved of the burdens of this office. And one of the things that I've said is that I will try and eke out a living in some other way. And I've speculated about the possibility of getting some romantic fiction done with heavily embossed purple covers of clematises.
So will you be leaving politics? Ladies and gentlemen, let's put this to the floor. Obviously shout yes if you want him to stay or no if you want him to go. Do you want Boris to stay?
Yeah.
Rather mixed, I think, Mr. Mayor. Would you like to see him run for national office?
Yeah.
Mr. Mayor.
Well, I'm going to fulfil my... Look, quite seriously, we've had a very good discussion, although Adam Bienkov didn't think much of what I had to say. I did my best to get over the points that I'm very proud of about what we're doing on housing. Since I've been mayor, you know, the story of London has changed. 6 years ago, everybody was worried about the thing you would have been shouting at me about was crime. It was about what's happening to our kids, and those issues still matter. We still have to take care of gang crime and of knife crime. We've made progress. We haven't solved it. We've made progress on the tube. We've made progress with transport. We haven't solved it. Housing has come up as a massive issue. We've got to deal with it.
Okay.
I've got 2 years left,
we will.
Got to deliver an Olympic
Last
race.
Question for now for the audience. It's a yes and a no, and be honest. Could you see Boris Johnson as PM? I don't think you quite won Greenwich. Let's talk crime. Let's talk crime.
No.
I want to go to
No is the correct answer, by the way.
I want to go to microphone 5. I'm changing the running order, I know. Crime, microphone 5. Where is microphone 5? Is it in the gods? Quickly wave, please. Microphone 5. Microphone 5, quickly. Yes, please. Up there, Mr. Mayor. Microphone 5. Go ahead.
Hello, good evening. I'm Julia, and coincidentally, I do live on the Harrow Road. I want to ask a question about police who work in police custody cells looking after prisoners. My next door neighbour does this, and she's been told that these jobs are going to go to the job centre. This is quite ridiculous when these are police officers who've trained for many years. Is this going to impact on people's ideas of safety on the streets if these jobs are going to go to the job centre?
Okay, that's custody cell staff, thank you. Let's go to microphone 6. Microphone 6. Again, up in the upper tier. Microphone 6. Can't see where it's going. Speak, please, right into the mic. Go ahead.
Hi, my name's Ben Farmer, community activist and Switzerland journalist. And I want to ask, what is Boris going to do to support our London communities at a time when police numbers are being cut and people are being increasingly suspicious of their own next-door neighbours?
Police numbers being cut, says the questioner. And thank you for that. A round of applause for the question. Let's show some enthusiasm, please, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. And microphone 4. Microphone 4. Wave like a crazy person. Right. Yes. Hello, sir.
Why has the Mayor's Office of Policing and Crime, MOPEC, got no black board or advisor members? Given the demography and youth of London... I'm over here.
Over there, Mr. Mayor. Over there, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, where are you?
Yeah.
Well, he's waving at you. He can't do any more. What do you want to do? Start a small
fire? Wait. I'm so sorry. Would you mind waving again?
He's there.
There, right. Sorry. There. Sorry.
Given the demography and youth and stop and search, disproportionate race and stop and search, it would be really quite advantageous to have black people at the top level.
Yes.
Okay, a good cluster of questions. Custody,
okay, right.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay,
custody cells, police numbers falling.
First of all, on what's happening with custody staff, I can't, I'm afraid, give you a very detailed answer to that one, but we will make sure that you do get an answer about what is happening. And obviously, we wouldn't want to do anything that prejudiced the professionalism and the safety of what takes place in custody, in police custody, and it sounds to me as though there may be a misunderstanding there. On Ben's question about general community spirit, what's happening to people's feeling of community in London? Well, actually, it is very interesting, because not only are police numbers still high in our city, unlike virtually everywhere else, which did take cuts in numbers over the last 4 or 5 years, we've been able to keep numbers high at or around 31,000-32,000. That's a pretty amazing achievement given the budgetary constraints that we have faced. And the evidence I have seen suggests that people are more confident in the police. And we've set a target for our police. We don't just want them to keep cutting crime, though that's important. We want people to feel that they trust the police more and more. And to get to the next question, that means having a police force that looks like London. And we are doing a huge amount to recruit from every ethnic community in this city. And Ray, who's in the front row, has been involved in that effort. And although progress is not as fast as I would like, we are making progress. And we've gone up, I think, from about 4% BAME in about 10 years ago to 11, 12% today. It is going up steadily under my mayoralty. And it is very, very important that we encourage that process. And we are starting to see the benefits of that in increasing confidence figures as well as declining crime figures.
Let me ask a question.
And as far as staffing goes in City Hall, and was that what you wanted me to do? We've got the full range of talents.
Well, not on the MOPEC. Is it MOPEC committee, I think you said, sir? Was that right? Have I got that right? Please just say yes. MOPEC.
Yeah, the Mayor's Office for Policing and Crime.
Mayor's Office for Policing and
Crime. There
apparently
are no black board members or advisors.
It's all white, is it? Is that
yes.
Right?
Well, yes. Ray Lewis, who's my lead for advice on this issue of recruitment and indeed mentoring and many other things for me, is here in the front row. And if you want to talk to Ray afterwards, you're most welcome.
Ray, could you just wave to everybody, Mr. Lewis? Thank you very much indeed. Mr. Mayor, you talk about the number of police officers. Is it not true since the time that you were re-elected The number of officers is down 7%. 2,400 officers.
Ray's not normally bashful about this. Sorry.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'll go back to where I was. The Met has lost 2,400 officers. It's down 7%. That is the reality, isn't it?
The reality is that, actually, I think by the end of this year, they will be up to, I think, was it 32,400? Which is pretty amazing.
Isn't that what you inherited from Ken Livingstone?
Which is pretty amazing when you consider that every other force has seen dramatic cuts in numbers.
Yeah, and but isn't that what you inherited from Ken Livingstone?
And we have not only kept numbers high, but we've kept crime coming down.
I think you know what I'm going to ask again. Isn't that what you inherited from Ken Livingstone, that number?
I think it's slightly more. In fact, it's slightly more. Thank you. Thank you. In fact, it's slightly... such is the astonishing management of police budgets under this mayoralty that in spite of the financial the squeeze that we've faced, actually, I think it is slightly north of the numbers we inherited under the previous mayoralty. So put that in your pipe and smoke it respectfully. You know, I don't say this... This is a very difficult argument because you shouldn't make a fetish of police numbers. The acid test is what are they doing? Where are they? Are they in our neighbourhoods? Are they out there? Are they being useful? Do they come when you want them? That's the real test. And I'm getting some feedback from the audience suggesting that not everybody is always satisfied. That's why we've set the target on confidence. We are driving down crime, but I want to see confidence come up as well.
All right. Let's do a couple of tweet questions here. This is from Jenny. Violent crime on transport is down, says the mayor. When was the last time you travelled on a bus? And this comes from Rachel in Leicester. Was it a waste of money, the hacking trial? Is Andy Coulson really a criminal?
I seldom off public transport buses, unless I specifically tell you otherwise. I am there, I'm with you.
Well, Jenny
I'm
says there everywhere still crime.
On buses. I think buses are absolutely fantastic, by the way. They are not awful. Who says that? Their buses
are wonderful. There's a young lady
there.
Why are they awful? Shout. Just shout. You can't breathe. The lady can't breathe. The heating is too much. There's no air conditioning and two go past her at once.
Well, I'm sorry, but I will look at...
In Streatham.
In Streatham. Okay. Well,
that's in Streatham.
Okay. Well, I listen. I hear you. I hear you. I will come to. I will make sure that when I say I'll come to your bus route, I will make sure that we look at which bus is it? Which number? The 109. Okay.
109.
Where's Isabel? Isabel's not here. TFL will be listening because TFL, in my experience, listens
where's
to everything.
Isabel? Where's the deputy mayor for transport?
She's sorting out another transport problem somewhere else.
Why isn't she sorting out transport problems in Greenwich?
Because we're mob-handed here tonight. We're mob-handed, and we got Andrew Gilligan, who's representing cycling, who's going to pass it back to her. Okay. The 109 in Streatham, we're going to look at. Right. But broad, I think we've got more buses now on the streets of London than ever before. I think they're fantastic. I love going shopping on a bus, which I never go shopping, but the only way to go shopping in London, in my view, is to go shopping on a bus.
All right, okay. There's a question regarding Andy Coulson as well. Microphone.
Yes,
is it
it's
three?
A big red thing.
Microphone three.
Hello, Boris. I just wanted to ask you, do you think David Cameron's apology with regards to Andy Coulson was a premature and further error of judgment on his part? I'm down here,
sorry,
by the way.
Hello.
Which naturally leads me on to ask, what would Boris do as our so-called putative leader, obviously Theresa May notwithstanding?
Yeah.
Would you have hired him in the first place? And also, if you did hire him, would you have put him through the clearance checks that naturally all of the previous leaders had done with their advisors, quote unquote, special advisors, such as Alistair Campbell? So, once again,
let me answer the question, please. Let me grope my way through that one. I think just my broad point about the whole hacking business is it had to be done. It was patently obvious that too much nonsense was some serious problems had. Grown into a lot of these newspapers. They were doing completely unacceptable, ethically unthinkable things. They were hacking people's phones the whole time in a systematic way. So that needed to be brought to justice. And I think, on the whole, after a lot of expenditure, the police have done a very good job. And I'm glad that some people have been brought to justice. I've got to be very careful in what I say.
No, you don't.
About, I think I do.
No, you don't.
About. I think, well, I don't know, because I just read the front page of the Evening Standard, which, of course, I consulted on my way here, suggested...
You can answer whether you'd have employed Andy Coulson. You can do that.
But on the specifics of the case, I think there's some issue of prejudice and contempt. So
you can answer whether
but
you'd
on have... whether I would have... That is a hypothetical question. That is a hypothetical question. Yes, because it reposes on the absurdity, the impossibility of my actually occupying Downing Street. I certainly don't believe in avoiding vetting processes and nothing like that.
So that was a mistake by David Cameron.
Let me tell you what I think about.
Let's just get an answer.
What David Cameron...
Was it a mistake?
What David Cameron had to say yesterday was, I thought, extremely right. And I agree passionately with the gentleman who's just heckled, saying that he thinks this is not about the real issue. And right. I think most members of the public agree with that.
Let's go to some issues in London. Let's go to microphone two. Microphone two. Madam.
Hello. To be on the road, all drivers, car drivers, must have a visual bike license plate on their cars. And that is linked to a central database. In London, if this was also made mandatory for cyclists, for a registration fee, a high-vis waistcoat, with their unique number to be issued to them, making all cyclists have to wear them on the road, making them accountable and responsible cyclists. So, Mr. Mayor, why have you not thought of this before, and why not act on it now? So I have made you this to give you a head start.
Okay, and just to explain to the listeners, we have a yellow over jacket with a TFL logo, and
thank
to massive
much.
Applause, I'll well, present it to you in just a second.
It's a tabard. I've been given a tabard.
One other question. Okay. Let's go to microphone four. Microphone four. Microphone four, speak. Go ahead. There.
Hi, as a wheelchair user, I rely heavily on customer service, good customer service, on the underground in providing ramps. This doesn't always work effectively. What better support is Boris providing on the new tube systems for disabled people, and will there be a better ramp system? Also, and will this be affected by the proposed cuts on staff members on the TfL?
Okay, better facilities, thank you. Round of applause for the questioner. And a final one in this batch on transport. Six. Wave at me six, if you would. Six. Right at the back there, Mr. Mayor. I'll point. Go ahead, please.
Hey. Hi, Boris. This is Shayna. I'm a black cab driver.
How are you?
Jolly good, thank you. I'd just like to know what sort of operating license you have given to Uber. It appears not to be the same as any other operator license that's been issued before. Can you explain, please?
So, thank you very much indeed.
Okay,
cyclists,
right.
Facilities for the disabled, and Uber.
First of all, on cyclists and the sort of, what I was detecting is the popular clamour for every cyclist to carry some sort of badge of shame or mark or licence. I think that the difficulty with that is it would, I'm afraid, discourage cycling. It would be very difficult to enforce. It would be another burden upon the police. I'm not inclined to go down that route. Where I think we have made progress recently is in Operation Safeway, which has been led by the Met, and large numbers of officers have been out there, and they have been stopping both motorists and cyclists who have been disobeying the law. And the most recent Safeway operation, they issued about 14,000 penalty notices, 70% of them, by the way, to drivers, only 25% of them, or 25%, I can't remember, who the other 5% go to, I have no idea. Anyway, 25% of them to cyclists. And the result has been a massive improvement in cycling behaviour. And I'm afraid that is revealed at least partly, or we think it is partly a reason why the number of cycling KSIs killed and seriously injured has come down dramatically.
Not total injuries, Mr. Mayor.
Not total injuries. And that is a very important factor. And I'll just give you, for ease of reference, of just comparisons, the volume of cyclists in London is now absolutely huge. It's gone up about 300% in the last 10 years or so. The number of cyclists who died on our streets last year was about, exactly 14. The number of serious injuries was about 450.
The number of total injuries was 4,623.
And if you go back to
the year before, it was 3,000. The year before that, it was 2,008.
Okay, hang on, you're going to confuse people.
No, I'm not. These are injuries, not serious injuries. These are total injuries, and it's on the increase, Mr. Mayor.
There's quite a serious.
And I don't know why this vest wouldn't help. Back to you.
Can I just finish the point with great respect?
Of course.
Because if you go back to 1989, when there were far fewer cyclists on the road, we had 33 deaths in a single year, and we had, I think, about 780 serious injuries. So many more deaths, many more serious injuries.
Well, not
the answer, in my view, is not to stigmatise cyclists, to impose some sort of new licensing system upon them. The answer is to enforce good and sensible behaviour by all road users. And that is what we are doing.
All right.
And we are seeing results. And I just want to say something about access on the tube, because of the new tube trains, obviously, will all new TfL equipment obviously will have proper disabled access. We thought that the manual ramps that we ran in the Olympics, they were effective. We're going to roll those many more of those out. We're now negotiating with the DfT about ensuring that every single one of the Crossrail stations, even if they're old historic stations, every single one has disabled access as our buses and our... I'm afraid it won't be, Nick, when Crossrail comes on stream, but it will be shortly thereafter. We are setting out a programme to make sure that every single one of the Crossrail stations, even the relatively low-use stations in comparatively underpopulated areas, get disabled access. And on Uber, I think this is a very difficult one, because I have to tell you that... I'm a passionate believer in our black taxis. I think they're a fantastic service for London. They're wonderful. They're a part of our transport network. And I can understand the argument of black cab drivers who say the Uber taxi meter, and when they put the mobile phone in the bracket and use it effectively as a taxi meter, that seems to me, superficially, with my basic understanding of the law, that seems to me to be in contravention of the 1907 Act. That is what I... Now, we have advice. We have advice from council that ain't so, that this is legal, and that if I block Uber from plying their trade on the streets of London... Has anybody here used an Uber device?
Okay, let's see.
Could I have a show if people have used Uber?
And it's literally less than 20, maybe 15 in a hall. Well, I'm counting up. All right, I'll give you 20 in all of 2,000. Okay.
Cut to the chase. What we're doing is we are testing this in the courts.
Should you have allowed it to go ahead prior to being heard before the court? Surely you should have stopped it, made sure it was legal before allowing Uber to start. Would that have made more sense?
Arguably, the difficulty was that we went straight to the lawyers, and they said, "I'm sorry, mate, this is legal, and you're going to be judicially reviewed, and you'll lose, and it'll cost TfL a packet, and you'll be at square one." So that was the problem we faced. I sympathise very much with the black cab trade, though I would say this, just to get back to where we were. When I talk to black cab drivers, and you're all going to, shout me down now, but my impression is that things aren't too bad in terms of the fares. What? My impression is there's quite a lot of business.
Is there a cab driver, very quickly, with a loud voice? Just anybody?
Answer the question.
Answer the
Why
question.
Why did you license them?
Because that was what the law said.
They don't meet the fundamental criteria for an operator's license.
Well, number one, they don't have a landline, no operating premises, and no fit and proper person.
And when Boris says things are quite good...
You should never have licensed them. Never mind the taxi meter.
All right. When Boris says things are quite good, would you agree things are quite good, wherever you are? Are things quite good for taxi drivers?
I just want to say on Uber that I sympathise very much with the black cab trade. There are limits to what I can do to go against the law. And if the law says that this is a legal system, then we have to test that. And I'm afraid the advice I had from our council, which is readily available, I expect under FOI, if you want to get it. The advice I had was that this was legal. So
we have
that was the problem.
We have your wise army of deputy mayors. Who is handling transport for the people in the audience when we depart the stage? Because the deputy mayor's not here.
Victoria Boris.
Victoria's waving white paper above her head. We may come back to transport if we don't. This young lady here in an appropriate dress.
I don't think you've got an answer, Nick, to your question about whether the black cab trade was genuinely feeling the benefits.
You really want to go back to that?
Well, okay. I'm a
cab driver again. Are you feeling the benefits? I think.
Yes.
Well, it's very good shouting yes, but we have no from the audience. Let's take another
chance. You had one rather feeble no.
All right, I'll leave it a little bit. Look. Okay, say that again about Oxford Street, sir.
Hang on, this gentleman's had enough of the taxi cabs. Right. There's quite a lot of taxi cabs in the audience, and they are citizens too.
Okay, all right. Just to remind everybody, you are listening to the State of London debate live here on LBC. And
Great.
Oh, good. I'd forgotten that. I'll do it again. We'll edit this out. We'll do that again. Just to remind everybody, you're listening to the State of London debate live on LBC. With London Mayor Boris Johnson. If you're not physically here, you can, of course, tweet your questions. Actually, let's just do one tweeted question here. This is coming in on the prices of buses and tubes. The prices are too high, says Alexander. What are you going to do about it? It seems they go up every other month under your reign.
No. Well...
And the
lady from Streatham, who is just abusing me for not having enough buses in Streatham and they're being too hot.
That's not abuse in Streatham, let me tell you.
Clapping because she wanted lower fares. And I just want to humbly and respectfully to point out to the audience, you cannot have it always. We kept the fare rises this year at lower than inflation.
No,
we kept
£15 to get to school every day,
we kept
madam.
Them
thank
at
you.
Lower than inflation. And
good luck with the exams.
If you want, can I possibly?
Shh. Let's listen to the mayor.
If you want to be able to get around the greatest city on earth, if you want us to be able to develop the housing sites that I've been talking about, and we had a really good discussion earlier on about housing, you have got to invest in transport. You've got to invest in mass transit. You've got to get people moving. And that, I'm afraid, means digging tunnels. It means putting in new signalling.
Yes,
it means
Mr.
putting
Mayor,
in new track.
Why does it
and
mean
that,
that
means
a Zone 1
stream
travel card has gone up from £34 to £45 in the last 4 years?
Well, reality is that...
Well, that's the reality. I've got the £34.60
plays
£45.
We have to cover the cost of our massive infrastructure investment in transport. And at the moment, the buses are the most heavily subsidised part of the transport network. They do, I'm afraid, require funding. And what I won't do.
We've got to shout that the operators pick up millions in subsidies is a claim from a gentleman in a white shirt. All right,
have also done, by the way, and I'd appreciate people, this is an important point, we have maintained and actually extended the Freedom Pass, which is now 24 hours on the buses. Does anybody remember that? And we have maintained, in fact, we awarded free travel to apprentices, to people in search of work, to job seekers. We have kept free travel for young people and those in education. Now, do you seriously want me to take those away? Do you seriously want me to take away free travel? You want me to take away your freedom pass? Is that what you want? No, we don't. There are no... But, well, gentlemen, if I just... Gentlemen, there, TfL is not a profit-making body.
We put every penny
into track, into buses, into investment in our system.
Otherwise,
I'm afraid we couldn't get on with the development of London.
Now, there's one other aspect of transport that's very fitting as we find ourselves in Greenwich.
Yes.
Which is, of course, the cable car.
Yes.
I wonder if you could make a lot of noise if you've ever travelled on the cable car.
Yay!
You win that one. A related question, microphone three. There. Sir.
Yeah, hi there. My name is Nat. I just wanted to point out to Boris that since he's become mayor, tube fares have gone up by 30%. And if Ken was able to freeze tube fares, I'm sure he could as well with making savings elsewhere.
No, he didn't. Well, what he did...
He did.
What he did was he did it for 1 year, and then the next year he whacked them up by an absolute record amount as soon as he'd been re-elected. And the whole thing was a complete con. So, you know, that is not the way to deal with the problem. That is not the way to treat Londoners. And what we have done is we've reduced delays on the tube by about 40%. The tube is now moving faster. We're able to extend the tube. We're able to run it to the two new stations on the Northern Line. And we've got plans now to extend the tube in South East London as well. Now, you could not do those great things if you followed a completely shameless, electorally driven policy of holding them down one moment and then whacking them up the next as soon as you get elected.
Let's have one last question on transport. We're going up there. Question number five. Microphone five. We've got a question on transport on microphone five. Over there, Mr. Mayor, up the top and on the left.
It's about the daily travel card. The cost of a travel card after 9:30 is £8.90. Before 9:30, it is £18. Why are you screwing the commuter?
Well, I must humbly repeat to you that obviously we try to encourage people to travel off peak where that is possible.
Well, if you look at
What we have to do on our network and the huge demands on the network. We're now carrying on both the buses and the tubes absolute record numbers. The demands are colossal. Unless we invest in that system, it will simply seize up. If we hadn't re-equipped the Jubilee line, you simply wouldn't be conveying people to the O2 as it is this evening. It is absolutely vital to keep that stream of investment in our transport system. And if we don't extend our tube networks, if we don't improve our suburban railway networks, then we will not be able to go ahead and build the homes that London needs. And I began with that point.
Okay, let's move on to other matters. We may well return to transport. There are other issues, so we're going to go to microphone one. Microphone one, over there, sir, that way.
Sir. Hi, Boris. You've spoken a lot about people beginning to feel the recovery in London and in the country as a whole, but isn't the real legacy of your time at Mayor that in the last 2 years, the rate of people using food banks has gone up 394%? Doesn't that just prove that your policies are for the rich and actually the majority of the people in this city haven't felt the recovery and inequality is getting worse?
Thank you for that question. Coming to that in a moment, sir, Mr. Mayor. Microphone four, we'll take a cluster on this. Microphone four. Yes, please go ahead. Sir.
Hi, Boris. My name is Wahid Rahimi. There is a growing gap between rich and poor in London. Why is it that? And what measures have you put in place to reduce and curb the increasing gap? Thank you.
Okay, sir, and one last one, similar theme, I think. We go up top, microphone six, up there, Mr. Mayor, microphone six.
Ellen from Elephant and Castle. The regeneration of deprived areas is fantastic, but how will you safeguard small business, private enterprise and community ventures and prevent homogenous high streets?
Great series of questions. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Right. On the gap between rich and poor and what's happening in London. Yes, there's absolutely no doubt that one of the features of of the way our system works is that people are able to accumulate huge sums of wealth, and there has been, over the last 30, 40 years, there has been an expansion in the gap between between rich and poor in financial terms. But if you look at what is happening in terms of the overall quality of life, people across the board are seeing improvements in their quality of life. You're seeing steady increases in, not just increases in life expectancy that I mentioned earlier, but one of the interesting things is actually that the gap between income groups in life expectancy under this mayoralty has started to narrow. It is absolutely true. And it is a fascinating reflection on what is on the quality of life in London. Yes, I agree, we need to work harder to put money into the pockets of those who need it. And that's why under this mayoralty, actually, we have massively expanded the London living wage. There's been something like a 700% increase in the number of companies paying the London living wage. I know that LBC pays the London living wage. They do. Congratulations.
Yep,
that has put about £60 million into the pockets of those who need it most in London. I urge all firms, everybody listening to this show tonight, think about the London Living Wage. It works brilliantly. It engenders loyalty and productivity in the workforce. And there are many, many companies in this city that are currently not paying it that could pay it. And it's £8.80 an hour. It's perfectly fair. It's what people should be paid at the absolute minimum here in London. And I urge companies to pay it. But it is, as I say, it has massively expanded under this mayoralty, and we have a huge campaign to increase it. But the best way to help people who are finding it tough in London, and many people are finding it tough in London, I totally understand that. The best way to help them is to get them, to help them into the jobs that they need to create the conditions for good employment and to allow them to get the homes that they need. And I'm sorry to come back to this again and again, but those are the things that the cost of housing, the cost of living that is sucking away people's disposable income. We must address that. We must address that problem.
The figure he quoted was 394% increase in the use of food banks. Mr.
Sorry, and I entirely accept that that is a phenomenon that, you know,
it's a divided city, let's be frank.
By the way, I congratulate those who are running the food banks. I mean, they're a new thing, and they're a wonderful thing, and it's quite right.
But it is a tale of two cities. You're a literary man. I want London
to be a city that has an absolute sense of unity and community. And that means that the people who are running the big companies should pay the London living wage, and the people should understand it. It should be an absolute priority for everybody in this city to make sure that everybody working here can live near their place of work. And those are absolutely critical things for the future economic success of our city.
What about the homogenisation of high streets, Mr.
Yes, Chair? I'm sorry. I just want to say on that, I think that's an excellent point. It is something that we are combating and have done for a long time now through the Outer London Fund. We put a lot of money into Outer London high streets, into high streets across the city, town centres, trying to encourage small shops, trying to make sure that and on the betting shops, so someone's I'm being heckled over there about betting shops, and that's a good point. We're adjusting the London plan, the further alterations of the London plan, to make it easier for councils not to give planning permission to undesirable shops such as betting shops, when I look at what's happening in some of our London high streets, it's fantastic. Some of them are absolutely fantastic, and they've been transformed through the Outer London Fund. Some of them are not so successful. They're dying, and it is very sad. But the answer, I'm afraid, my friends, is for everybody to shell out and go to their local shops, isn't it?
Yes.
Rather than go to Tesco.
Yes.
Not that we got it. The solution to this problem is in our hands. Not like I've got anything against Tesco before they ring me.
Let's stick with this theme. Hold on one second. Put your hand up and make sure one of the LBC team comes to you. Listening, of course, to the State of London debate here with Mayor Boris Johnson on LBC. Great. Microphone four, please, a related question. Microphone four. Wave like a crazy person. Thank you. Yes.
Hiya, my name's Vicky. I'm from East London, Leighton. Going back to affordable housing, who is the affordable housing for? What do you call affordable housing, and what
constitutes affordable housing?
Yes, well, also, and okay. What wage bracket are these people in?
Okay. Well, Mr. Mayor, what's the average price of a London home?
The average price of a London home has been going up steadily.
It's now about between
450 and 500,000.
It is, £485,000. How are people meant to afford that?
It is, look, I mean, I totally accept that it is these homes are moving beyond the reach of most people, but on Vicky's question, what we mean by affordable housing is it's got to be an average of 65% of the market rent, whatever that is for the area, and in many cases
in Camden it's 80%.
In many cases it will be as low as 40%.
In Camden it's 80%. How are people meant to afford that?
Because that's the top that Camden are allowed to charge. They must ensure that their average is 65%. So they won't. Not all the properties will be.
It's stated
at
80%. You need a combined income of £100,000 a year.
And the answer to the question who are these homes for? They're for everybody. They're for the people who work in London and upon whom the London economy absolutely depends. Those are the people we're trying to support.
All right. Let's take a tweet question. Neil Walsh, what are you doing about the problem in Tower Hamlets with possible electoral irregularities? Are you leaving us to rot?
No, I think it's very important that I've obviously been briefed on this by the police, and I think it's very important the police be allowed to get on with their investigations. Nothing could be more serious than allegations of electoral fraud and malpractice in a London borough. Why is London so incredibly successful? It's because people think that in this city we have the rule of law and that our political system, by and large, is not tainted with corruption and malpractice. Now, if we're going to lose that reputation, that will be absolutely catastrophic. And it is very important that the police get to the truth. And I know that they're working very hard on what they tell me is a very, very large number of allegations. So one of the difficulties they face is knowing exactly which rat to chase down, which hole, as it were.
Feasibly,
if you think of them as terriers.
Feasibly, could the election be rerun?
Well, you know, that you'd have to wait for the outcome.
No, I said feasibly. You'll be aware of what.
If it is proved that there has been electoral malpractice and the poll has been shown to be tainted and corrupt, then of course it's got to be rerun.
Okay. Florence in Barrow and Furness. Then we'll come back to questions in the hall. Florence in Barrow and Furness, or Furness, I think it should be pronounced. I apologise. You've said a lot about the living wage. When you become Prime Minister, will you enforce it? I think you have a fan in Florence.
I do believe in this. I think there's absolutely no reason why Conservatives shouldn't make this a central part of our programme. This is something that I think is an unalloyed good. There is no downside, in my view, for the companies that pay it. It is something we should campaign for. It's something we should crusade about. I think that, people have said we're a divided city. I don't believe that we're a divided city. We should be a united city. But this is one way we should insist upon that.
Yeah. The question was, would you insist on putting in the living wage? Yes or no?
Well, we already have a minimum wage, which is a statutory...
I'll try
legal,
again.
Statutory... your question
Florence's,
is... Your question
not is, my question, with respect. It's Florence's question. Would you insist on putting in the living...
Well, the point about the living wage is, at the moment, is it's not compulsory.
Would you make it compulsory?
What you're really asking is, would you raise the minimum wage to the level of the...
Whichever way you'd like to,
the,
you would.
...of the living
yes?
wage. And I think you'd have to look at that. I mean, I think the difficulty...
But what does that mean? Yes
the
or no?
The difficulty with that...
We've looked at
I think,
it.
I prefer... We've had a massive expansion of the living wage, and I prefer the system of moral suasion that is working at the moment, that is getting companies to see that it's the right thing to do for their employees, and indeed for their own bottom line. Yeah. And I prefer that to instituting some new piece of legislation. And,
okay.
And there you go. I would rather stick with that approach.
Okay. Let's come back to some transport seemed to be a burning issue. We've talked a lot about housing. Let's come back to that. We go up to the upper level. Microphone six, if you would. If you could wave at me. Thank you. Microphone six. Just coming down here. And off we go. Thank you.
Mr. Johnson, Alec James from Islington. Sir. Air pollution is a serious concern for Londoners at the moment. We know that old diesel black cabs are a big contributor to this. How come we don't have hybrids like in New York?
Right, thank you.
We'll take one more on transport. Is microphone five ready to go on transport? Microphone five, are you ready to go on transport as quick as you can? It's again up in the gods. It's right at the back. Follow my hand. Hybrid cabs is the first one. Microphone five. He's run out the room. No, he's up there now. Oh, he ran around the back. Okay, let's go with a question. Young man in a white shirt. Sir.
Hi, Boris. It's about the congestion zone, CO2 emission,
yes. And
the American embassy. So, as we know, all these years, the congestion charge was rising and going up and up and up, right? CO2 emission never go down for 2 seconds or for 2 milligrams, right? Tell me exactly how much did American embassy paid for congestion charge. And on a positive note, next time when you be a prime minister, on a briefing meeting with English football team, would you just tell them if they don't get into the last 16 so we can freeze their assets when they come back?
Brilliant. Brilliant. Thank you, sir. Right, hybrids like New York, right. Congestion charge, the US, how much did the US embassy owe us?
They owe us about a thick end of £9 million, to the best of my recollection.
£9 million.
Do you think they should cough up?
Yeah.
Yes, so do I. Should we? What's that? No one should. Sorry. That's well. Okay. Just on the gentleman there says it's the whole thing's a disgrace. But listen, don't forget, by the way, that we got rid of the Western Extension Zone of that thing, and the £25 charge on family vehicles that was going to be imposed by a certain former mayor whose name I barely remember. Just quickly on the clean taxis, because it is what you said is absolutely true. Whoever said it, I've lost it. What you said about quality of air in this city is absolutely true. We're losing too many people to premature deaths from poor air quality. They calculate about 4,000. We are making progress. I mean, we've reduced emissions of NOx by 20%, of PM10s, PM2.5s by 15%, but we've got too many diesel vehicles on the streets of London spewing out particulates. And what you need to do is have in the centre an ultra-low emission zone where you've got very, very clean, green vehicles.
Well, what about
vehicles?
These hybrid cabs that will come in, you asked, like New York?
Yeah, we're moving towards them. I don't want to be... we're moving... We will, by 2020, you will have... If you're,
how many people
if
will die from poor air quality by 2020?
Because you've got to be fair. You've got to be fair to the... owner-driver of black cabs who invest huge sums of money in what is their most expensive asset, and you've got to give them due warning and due time before they have to get another one.
All right.
And it is just not fair. So you've got to get... And the technology is now there. The financing is going to be possible. There will be a range of choices, and we will really help the black cab trade. There will be... By the way, these are fantastic-looking vehicles, some of these. Fantastic. They look like classic black cabs, but they are either electric or they have range extenders, and we'll go forward with them as we come up to 2018 and then 2020. There are two deadlines that we are setting on CO2. Can I just simply say on CO2, how much does this audience think CO2 has fallen in the last 6 years? CO2 emissions have fallen. It has not gone up. In spite of the massive growth of the London economy, CO2 emissions have actually come down by 14%. So that I think is a tribute to the technological changes that we are seeing. And on the question about the England football team,
the team talk,
and what I would say to the England football team, I thought they tried. I really do. No, I do. I thought they put in. No, come on. I thought they put in a really... They could have tried harder. They could have tried harder, but we should not imitate Uday and Qusay Hussein, if you remember, because they actually, I think, used to electrocute the members of the Iraqi team if they failed to perform. I'm not remotely suggesting that. What I am saying. Oh, right. What?
Okay, come to you next.
I'll come to you in a moment.
Just finish the speech. What would you say to England football players? Let's get a microphone to that gentleman.
I think the team are badly. I would pass a serious current through the management. I would get them. Take away their pay if they fail to get us into the last 16.
So Hodgson must go.
Well, I'm not saying that. Just don't pay him a penny if he fails.
Okay. All right. We've got two questions. We're going to go one and two. Microphone one. You started your question. I think it was about Hammersmith. Microphone one. Briefly,
bankers.
It's only 18 years old.
Yep.
Beautiful houses. I've got great neighbours. Black, white, Christian, Muslim. We get on really well. 2 years ago in People's Question Time, I spoke to Boris, you may remember me, and I asked you if... Yes, my name is Mr. David McGinty.
Just move to your question if you would, sir. Sorry.
If you were going to protect our neighbourhood, which you categorically said you would, since then, for months, I've been waiting to hear whether you have signed a document to say whether you're going to demolish our flats or not. So I'm going to ask you right now...
Well, which one is it?
Simple yes or no.
What is the name of the flat, sir?
It's Carmel Road, it's Hurlingham... Hurlingham Industrial Park, it's a regeneration going on in Fulham. Have you signed the document to bulldoze our homes?
Okay, while
yes
he consults
no?
with the Deputy Mayor, thank you. We will come to that after we take
I
one more
question. I don't believe we have, but I'll make sure cycling, that we get a proper,
okay,
proper answer.
Okay, can we take question number two? Was it on cycling, hopefully? Question number two. Yes, sir.
Barclays have said that they're going to pull out of sponsoring your Boris bikes, even though they said that they weren't going to until 2018. And TfL have said that in 2015 it will cost $225 million to the taxpayer. How can you justify the continuation of the Boris bikes?
All right, he's over there. The gentleman's
Where
over
is
there.
He doesn't like the bikes.
He doesn't like the bikes. Are you demolishing Hurlingham Road first?
Well, I don't think we are, but I will, I'm going.
Well, you
I'm,
must know. I mean, it's a quite an important thing with
I'm,
respect.
Yes, I know. I know it is. But I'm not going to. I'm not going to make a statement that I have to retract if I can possibly avoid it. I will check. What the answer is indeed yes or no. So I will have to.
Right.
You'll have to forgive me. I'm gonna have to give you.
The mayor is with me next week.
I think I'm almost certain the answer is no, but I don't want to be categorical.
Well, I guarantee you, the mayor is with me next week on LBC. Eddie, we will deliver the answer.
Are we aware of demolition
on LBC?
No,
everybody.
LBC.
Now we come back to the gentleman here, Barclay. Why have
yes,
Barclays,
well, I don't why know why he's I don't know why he's being so hostile to the bicycles. I think the bicycles are a fantastic addition to the streetscape of London. I think that they're something that millions.
How much have they cost, Mr. Mayor?
We've had huge numbers of users, and the cost has been very substantially defrayed, as you know, by getting.
Well, how much did they cost, Mr. Mayor?
They cost a bob or two. They cost
a bob or two. Would that be £180 million?
I think that's a bob or two.
That,
I think you're factoring in all the capital costs as well as the maintenance costs.
How much was the Barclays sponsorship
initial cost,
deal worth?
The initial cost of the installation of those bicycles was
£180 million.
I'm not certain.
And what was the
I think your figure is wrong, by the way. It wasn't anything like as high as that. But yes, there was an investment in cycling in London, and I think that was an important thing to do. I think that if you look at the history of the whole sponsorship negotiation, actually Barclays came through with by far the largest
£25 million.
£25 million, which is not to be sneezed at.
It is not, but not with 180.
Which is not to be sneezed at. Mm. And I dispute your figure.
I dispute your figure. How many potential sponsors are in the bidding now, Mr.
And
Mayor?
We have about 12 in the frame now, of which six are very keen. And
when might we know?
And you'll have action. I'm not going to give you a deadline by when you'll have news, but you will have news in the fullness and richness of time, and we're very confident. We think it is a great scheme. It's the most popular bike-hire scheme in the world. It's used by huge numbers of people every day. I think we've had about 28 million rides on bikes. People love them. They use them to get to work, to go around the city. I think it's a fine investment in London. If I'm honest with you, I think it's a fine investment in London. I totally defend it.
Okay. Thank you. Indeed, show your applause, your appreciation of the mayor. Please do. I've got a tweet question regarding the Barclays cycle hire. This comes in from Raquel in Sussex. I saw you last week. One moment, madam. I will come to you in a moment. Thank you. I saw you last week with Jeremy Paxman on Newsnight on a tandem. If you had a choice of taking Michael Gove or Theresa May on a tandem, to ask Raquel, who would it be and why?
Well, you know, they've got these brilliant... I think they've got these... What I would do is I think I would... If they weren't about to be banned, I would take them on a rickshaw. That's what I would do. I would take them both. There you go.
And if it was a tandem...
How feeble is that?
Totally feeble. And if it was a tandem, which one would it be?
Well, I think it would be Invidious. It would be Invidious to choose between any of my... my admired and esteemed colleagues in government.
A rickshaw made for three. All right.
But I'm sure, by the way, I'm sure we could get them all on a Barclays bike. It's an absolutely true story. I took both my children on my bicycle once without there you go. That was before I was mayor, so and before the days of iPhone photographs and all the rest of it. And it was absolutely right. I had one of them on the seat and one of them on the handlebars.
It's gone very quiet, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah,
do you
I
think?
Know.
How advisable?
Why am I telling you this?
How advisable was that?
It's not advisable.
So don't why did it. You do it?
Because it was fun. That's why I did it.
And fun is more important?
Well, I think, I mean, you know, as I said just now, KSIs on our streets are down to lows that we've never seen before. It's fantastic tribute to the work of everybody involved in our transport system, to our ambulance service, and to the police. But I think kids are entitled to a bit of a sense of risk.
And if you saw someone doing that tomorrow, what would you say to them?
I would obviously tick them off. I would arrest them.
Thankfully,
I managed to get away with doing it long before I was elected.
We've got 9 minutes, so let's rattle through questions as quick as you can. Answers, even, Mr. Mayor, if you can. Microphone one. Where are you? Have we got microphone one? If we're not, we're going to move on very quickly. Microphone one. Someone go there. Okay, let's go to six. Microphone six. Is six good to go? Let's go. Sir, at the top, Mr. Mayor, in the centre. Go, sir, please.
Hi, I'm Louis, and recently in the news I heard that funding for young people's mental health is falling. How are NHS going to hope?
Let's take that answer straight away, if you would, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. This is something that we are indeed concerned about, and one of the reasons I've just set up a new London Health Board is so that we can campaign as London on precisely this kind of issue. Mental health is one of the things that we are particularly concerned about, and I think it'd be fair to say that Lord Darcy, who's leading the London Health Commission for us in London, is doing a survey of what is going on in London. Healthcare completely shares that view. And if you talk to the police and about the problems they face and the interface between mental health and crime, they feel that not enough is being done. So we want to see significant progress from the NHS in investment in healthcare, in mental health care in London. I think it's a complete Cinderella at the moment, mental health care in London. It is not being properly treated, not being properly funded, and if you want to see real reductions, long-term reductions in crime, improvements in quality of life, you've got to address and better achievement in schools, you've got to address mental health care in particular, and that's why we've... And if you want any more on what we are doing to champion mental health care services in London, please talk to Victoria, who's my deputy mayor, statutory deputy mayor, and also leads for me on health.
It's going to be an incredibly busy lady down the front here, waving her pad now. Yes. Microphone one. Thank you, Victoria. Microphone one. Microphone. Quick as you could, if you would, sir, madam. Thank you.
Boris, you mentioned that crime is going down. In fact, crime is going down
but the police are increasing criminal activities against a lot of residents. There's been a lot of raids, what police have been doing, without showing a warrant. Right. And there are a lot of families that are hurting and crying. We had a meeting with our new borough commander, Richard Wood, who's trying to engage with us, but there's a lot of families that are crying that the police are not doing their job. My question is, in Brixton, Boris, my question is, and petition is, can the police have cameras when they're doing their raids so that they do it properly in Brixton?
Yes, I can answer your question, and I can answer it in the affirmative. Because that's exactly what, I've got Stephen Greenhalgh and Blair Gibbs in the front row from the MOPAC, who will be happy to talk to you afterwards about what we're already doing in Sutton and I think other places now with body-worn cameras. I completely agree with you that members of the public need to have the security of knowing that they're not going to be mistreated by the police, that they won't be fitted up, that whatever the police say happens did indeed take place, and we think that body-worn cameras will make a big, big difference, and they will be a deterrent to misbehaviour on either side.
Deputy Mayor Greenhalgh, would you just wave to everybody?
And members of the public will know there's a limit to what they can get away with as well. So, yes, we're certainly going to roll that out.
Microphone six, up in the gods. Yes, there. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Boris. Recently, I read that you spend more time in Doha than Dagenham and more time in Paris than Purley. Have you given up on the Outer London Ring? And have you become the Zone 1 mayor that you accused Ken Livingstone of becoming?
Absolutely not. Unless I specifically tell you otherwise, I am in some place in Outer London pounding the high streets, canvassing, badgering people, and trying to see what is going on. And yes, you can find particular chunks of time where I've been off somewhere else, and you compare it to the amount of time I may have spent in some out of London borough over that particular month. And it might conceivably be true that I spent more time in Paris than in Peckham on one Tuesday in March or whatever. But the reality is that me and my team are out across London the whole time. And I can't remember the exact statistics, but I think something like we've done far more visits to not just random journeys that I happen to make in a personal or political capacity, but far more official mayoral visits to Outer London under my mayoralty than there ever were before. Okay. And we're going to continue with that.
Mr. Mayor, I've got a final tweet question. Bobby in Birmingham. If you do go into national politics, how can we trust you? You've broken your promise in London about ticket offices on the tube.
Well,
that's a tweet question.
On ticket offices.
You did campaign saying you would keep them open, I believe.
In 2008. And what I also said in 2012, when I campaigned for another mandate, was that you had to modernise and automate the system. And the truth is that since I was elected in 2008, there has been a steady and significant improvement in the whole automatic ticketing technology. More and more people use the Oyster card. We're now moving to bank card payment on the tube as well as on the buses. Things have moved on, and I think one answer I should have amplified a bit earlier on, the person who asked a question about help for disabled people. By the reforms that we're putting in train, we will be able to get more people onto the concourses, onto the platforms, to help everybody who needs help with their tickets, help with their Oyster card, whatever it happens to be. And they will be. Technology has changed now. People can now carry devices that will enable them to solve all your problems and to help people who are physically in need of help and of guidance. And on the bigger stations, there will be something like a 31% increase in the number of actual human beings who will be able to engage with you, engage with us and help us.
Point well made. Let's get at least one more question in. Microphone four. There, please. Yes.
Hi, Boris. Following your decision to go ahead and buy some water cannon a couple of weeks ago, when are we going to see you stand in front of one and prove just how safe these are, like you promised on LBC?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch this.
Yes, we got it from the decision to buy the water cannon. What did you say next, sir? Sorry.
On LBC a few weeks ago, you promised to stand in front of one and demonstrate yes. just how safe they are. When are we going to see that?
Yes, well, that will depend. I can imagine there's going to be a certain amount of... I think both
you are
Nick,
going
Nick,
ahead.
Nick,
yes,
Nick
yes.
and I are both yes. doing it, by the
do
way.
Do you want me to stand in front of a water cannon?
Yes.
Then I am your servant. Yes. I shall do it.
And I listen, because when Nick asked me that question on the radio, it hadn't occurred. Yes, I'm sure there'll be plenty of people here who'll be only too happy to pull the trigger.
Are you going to do it, Mr. Mayor?
I shall do it, and I'll do it for this reason, because I don't want... Look, let's be absolutely clear. I don't want these things ever to be used on the streets of London. I don't want them ever to be used. However, I have to respect the advice of the police and their strong view that there might...
So you're buying something you'll never use.
There might be circumstances. There might be circumstances when they could save life and limb, they could save damage to property if right. they had this additional tool, which, is, by the way, is an intermediate tool. They already have baton rounds, and I'm not proposing to stand in front of a baton round.
Okay. But I will stand. The challenge is on,
and I'm not proposing... They already have the power to launch horse charges. I'm not proposing to stand in front of a horse charge. But
just,
because I don't think it would be right, as your elected mayor... To bring these, at least theoretically, onto the streets of London, yes, I will conduct an experiment with you, because I think that I should test it if I'm going to ask Londoners to do so.
And on that challenge, we must end. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for all your questions and comments, your appreciation for the Mayor of London, Boris Johnson.
Thank you.
The debate continues with Ian Dale on LBC. Hooray. You can watch the whole thing online right now at lbc.co.uk. Don't forget, if you didn't get to ask your question, you've another chance next Tuesday when Mayor Johnson joins me again on LBC at 9 a.m. for Ask Boris. Ian Dale is next. Ladies and gentlemen, and Mr. Mayor, thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Well done. Mr. Nick Ferrari.